HarperCollins presents Our Daily Bread, From Argos to the Altar, A Priest Story, written and read by Alex Frost. Foreword by Alistair Campbell. "We don't do God" is perhaps the most oft-repeated soundbite of my time in politics. It is often interpreted as an anti-faith statement. It is not, and was never intended as such. It was my way of saying I did not believe that the public liked to see politicians relate their faith to their politics. Indeed, I am a pro-faith atheist. I don't do God myself, though my believing sister Liz constantly assures me God does you. I'm also extremely pro-people of God who do good, and Father Alex is very much in that category. That became all too clear in the powerful BBC News documentary, The Cost of COVID, A Year on the Front Line. The documentary focused both on his work and on that of Pastor Mick Fleming from the Church on the Street Ministries, showing the many families affected by extreme poverty in Burnley, Lancashire. Like millions of people, I was deeply moved by the film and horrified to witness the levels of deprivation that have hit parts of the North, and indeed many parts of the UK. Sadly, it didn't come as any great surprise, as I have been concerned and publicly vocal about the austerity measures that have crippled much of Britain before, during and since the global pandemic. It was hard not to be affected by the stories and people featured in this news item, and I was delighted to see the piece recognised at the recent RTS Awards. Father Alex and I share a passion for football. We are both dedicated supporters of Burnley Football Club and have followed the club for decades. We have seen times of great success, including a number of years in the Premier League, a brief foray into European football, and the spectacular development of the infrastructure of our ground turf moor, with training facilities on the edge of town, near to the beautiful Gawthorpe Hall. We also both know what it is to suffer as fans of the Clarets, and have both lived through the club's numerous failures and near misses, though with some exceptions, including the nail-biting encounter that saw Burnley narrowly beat Orient FC in May 1987 to retain our place in the Football League. I also spotted Alex on social media, where he hosts his aptly named podcast, The Godcast, and was delighted to accept an invitation, not least so I could adapt that soundbite to "I don't do God, but I do the Godcast." Despite being interviewed thousands of times by journalists in the media, which can make me a bit bored and formulaic, I found our discussion a refreshing and at times fearless one. It isn't often I'm asked to talk about God or faith, and asked to do so in such a spirit of compassion and empathy. This way of speaking in the public eye is perhaps a challenge to all politicians to seek the common ground, to argue better, as Father Alex goes on to discuss in this timely and important book. I was struck by Alex's remark so much that I mentioned him in an article I wrote for The Independent in December 2020. Father Alex's call for a kinder, compassionate approach to politics and life shouldn't be underestimated. This book has numerous accounts of kindness overcoming greed, action overcoming austerity, and dare I say it, light overcoming the darkness. Father Alex's skill is that he does his work with humour, empathy, and a down-to-earth approachable spirituality. While I may not feel called to be a weekly disciple at the foot of the cross, I deeply respect and admire those who are, and understand that for many people spiritual well-being is as essential to well-being as anything else. Father Alex's reminder that poverty extends far beyond financial scarcity is an important matter to be considered if the current government's levelling up agenda is ever to be truly lived out as an aspiration that is achievable and not merely end up as yet another slogan devoid of substance. Father Alex makes the point that before tarted up town centres and renovated clock faces, priority should be given to those who need it most, and frankly, I couldn't agree more. Our Daily Bread is a unique and rare insight into the work of an urban parish priest. Without the church's engagement with such matters of social injustice and voluntary support, many places would be in a much graver situation than they already are. Father Alex gives a true picture of what it is like when people on the fringes of society get left behind or forgotten about. The stories at times are deeply moving and harrowing, and one cannot fail to reflect on the impact that the pandemic and cost of living crisis are having on some of Britain's most deprived communities. And yet, Father Alex also manages to draw out something of these communities that brings hope and inspiration. Amid the unfairness and injustice, there is also humour, love and togetherness, restoring hope in and towards humankind and the solutions that involve spiritual serenity. This book is an essential read for anyone who believes poverty doesn't exist. It is an essential read for anyone who believes the societal landscape is already level. And it's an absolute must-read for anyone who believes that the church doesn't have an essential role to play in effecting change and calling out injustice. Father Alex and I probably won't live long enough to see Burnley lift the Premier League trophy and win a place in the Champions League, but we certainly share the same aspiration that people living in poverty shouldn't need to wait a lifetime for change to happen. I applaud Father Alex for speaking out as frankly as he does. I applaud him for sticking his head above the parapet and being brave enough to hold politicians and the church to account when they fail the people of our great country. It would be my hope that politicians, journalists, and broadcasters read this book and consider what they do differently to change the roadmap that affects so many of our estates and urban settings. What actions can they take that might change the destination of travel for places where addiction, crime, abuse have become almost normalised over many years under the stewardship of politicians of all persuasion? Who will make a difference? How will they make a difference? And most importantly, when will they make a difference? These are the stark and important questions that urgently need answers. Father Alex is a hard-working Church of England priest. He says himself that he doesn't have all the answers, but he deserves our thanks for asking the question. Alistair Campbell, May 2022. Give us this day our daily bread. Matthew 6, verse 11. Prologue. Blessed. Blessed are you who are poor, as yours is the kingdom of God. Blessed are you who are hungry now, as you will be filled. Blessed are you who eat now, for you will laugh. Luke 6, verses 20 to 21. In the darkest days of the pandemic, people from the estates that spread out from around St. Matthew's the Apostles' Church in Burnley queued in the bitter cold for makeshift food parcels handed out in a car park by me and another clergyman, Pastor Mick Fleming. People who'd lost their jobs, who were ill and cold in wheelchairs, who were isolated and alone, and who could not afford to feed their kids or warm their homes, waited, sometimes impatiently, for a bag of cheap pasta and a few tins of baked beans. In Luke's Gospel, it says, "Blessed are the poor." Well, I can tell you, they don't feel very fucking blessed, and I didn't see anyone laughing that night as we handed out the food donated by our community. In fact, if you've ever seen news reports on the telly of the Red Cross handing out food from the back of a lorry in Syria or Rwanda, then you've got an idea of the need and the chaos we have seen on the streets of modern Britain. As a priest, I get to walk in the shoes of some of society's poorest, most deprived and suffering people in the beloved northern town I call home. I get to walk the streets of the estates I've come to love, and the people I've come to admire in all their resilient, vulnerable, brazen glory. Amid these once cobbled roads that are lined with Coronation Street-style terraced houses and run-down council homes, I get to live the gospel of Jesus Christ, which tells us simply to help the needy and love thy neighbour. This is a place where people shop in their pyjamas, where Christmas lights go up in October to bring some kind of cheer, where disagreements are often played out publicly in front yards, with fights or loud arguments, where the police force and social services are frequent visitors. It is a place where people learn early on about survival, where school is a passing interlude between the business of eking out a living, where you learn which families are not to be messed with, and where grassing people up is the worst crime. It might be more George from Asda than Giorgio Armani, but it is a place of real beauty. There is a community here. All the families know each other, and people look out for each other. It is a place where kids play on the streets until it gets dark, and where fireworks go off all year round to honour loved ones who have died. If you weren't born into poverty or didn't grow up on one of Britain's urban estates, you might associate a place like this with all the negative stereotypes. You might imagine that all the mums are single parents, that every other house is a shithole, and everyone is living on state benefits. Well, this is true in many cases. It isn't true of everyone, as the people you'll read about in these pages demonstrate. They have challenges, which you'll also read about, drug problems, having to feed their kids on one wage, struggles paying the bills, facing all sorts of antisocial behaviour. But they are the people with big hearts and souls who are, in turn, humorous, frustrating, loving and, at times, completely impossible to figure out. Being a priest has given me special access to this community, where an outsider is usually an outsider for a long time before being trusted. I honour that trust deeply, and I know it is a privilege which I do not take lightly. I wasn't born into a religious family, but instead came into the church at the ripe old age of 40, bemused and wondering what the bloody hell had happened to make me want to wear a dog collar. Well, God happened. Jesus' word happened, and now I am his disciple. I practice what I preach by running food banks for the neediest, by attempting to follow the gospel and help those who most need it. My faith wasn't indoctrinated into me. My formation as a Christian crept up on me. It made gentle introductions. It left subtle deposits, just as my puppy does sometimes. Slowly but surely, I arrived at a place of acceptance, tranquility and spirituality. That spiritual place ultimately led me to a physical place, which was St. Matthew's Church. It is a place of real joy, of pain and of suffering, and God has been there in all of it from beginning to end. Burnley has its fair share of problems. It sits within the most deprived 10% of lower-tier local authorities in England, according to a report published in 2019 by the Ministry of Housing, Communities and Local Government. It sits within the 20% of the most health-deprived and high-disability areas in the Lancashire 12 area. Trinity and Bank Hall wards in Burnley are the most deprived in the whole country. If you think that 55% of our children qualify for free school meals, rapturous austerity measures saw to that, then you can see we are a community on the edge, permanently on the brink of disaster. Then, the pandemic happened and the fallout has been catastrophic. In light of the scenes of utter misery and deprivation as people were handed out food bags from our pop-up food bank in a Burnley car park, what do the words of Luke above mean? No one could look at the people in my parish, pushing each other at times to try and get to the front of the queue, so they'd have something to eat that night, and say, "Blessed are the poor," could they? It's a challenging one to unpack. To my mind, poverty or poorness isn't just about financial deprivation. It is spiritual poverty, emotional poverty, poverty of aspiration, poverty of evolution in people's life, poverty of well-being. It is about people being forced to live in appalling housing conditions, owing money to loan sharks, or having spiralling debt. It is about people who are suffering from mental or physical health issues, or having a poor education, few job prospects, and at the mercy of overwhelmed support services. It is very easy to be a disciple, to follow Jesus' message, when the sun is shining and things are going well. But what about when they aren't? What about when we are faced with suffering? When we are faced with trauma or grief or being unable to feed our kids, what then? I refuse to normalise the depths of deprivation I come into contact with each day. It is beyond poverty. It's destitution. I see mums who have to decide between replacing a broken kettle and feeding their children. I hear terrible stories of people left in crisis for months.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.